Hello everyone, welcome to our YouTube live session. Feel free to use the chat box to tell us where you're joining from. And we'll get started in about a minute as we wait for people to join in. Why don't we get started? Thank you everyone for joining. We'll do a quick intro before we dig into our session today. My name is Charlie Ogden. I'm a product manager at Autodesk, focused on grading and drainage features for our infrastructure products, mainly Civil 3D and InfraWorks. And we also have Val.
Thanks, Charlie. And by the way, happy birthday. My name is Val. I'm a research engineer at Autodesk. And yeah, I'm excited to do this live session with you guys.
We also have John.
Morning, everyone. My name is John Sarah. I'm a technical marketing manager here at Autodesk. I also would like to wish Charlie a happy birthday. We've been talking about that. We were maybe going to embarrass him right in the middle of this webcast, but we thought we'd go ahead and break the ice and let everybody know. So. Looking forward to answering your questions today. I will be doing Q&A and like to just tell you, ask away. If you've got a question, just put it in the chat and I will do my best to answer that question. So, great.
As you may see, today's session is part one of six YouTube Live Ask Me Anything sessions to help you learn more about grading optimization for Civil 3D. And under this video in the description, you'll find all the links to the future sessions. So make sure you set reminders to watch those as well. The next one's in 2 weeks from today. Also, please ask questions in the chat. As John said, he'll be answering questions there. We'd love to hear what you're thinking. And we'll also have a Q&A session at the end of the presentation if there's still unanswered questions. With that, we can get started here. So first we want to just start with a little information on what grading optimization is for and when to use it. So, you know, one case you might be used to in Civil 3D, if you're grading something simple like a building pad, and in this case, the blue line, and there's two elevations that you know you want the pad at, and you know you want to grade out, say, 10 feet away from that at a 2% slope, and then grade out and tie into existing ground. You basically know exactly how you want to grade this, and there's really no reason in this case to use grading optimization. Not that you can't, but I just don't think this is the type of case that's going to save you time, because you know exactly how to grade it. Where you want to use grading optimization is cases where there's a lot more going on and you're not sure upfront exactly, you know, how you're going to grade it from one piece to another with the exact slope already known. So something like this, where there's maybe a building pad over here again, and maybe you know exactly what elevation you want that at, but then you have grass area around it, a sidewalk leading to a parking area, and that sidewalk could be 1% to 5%. The parking lot on one side, a parking lot on the other side, and each of those themselves could be some range between 1 and 5 or more percent. You could just start and grade with a certain percent, but you're not necessarily going to get maybe the best solution. It is also constrained because this parking lot needs to tie into existing elevations on this road in the front at four spots. Also tie in the back, and it might be complicated here with the steep slope out back. And there's also drainage to consider and making sure that that all flows out by gravity, flows into, you know, wherever it's going at not too low of an elevation to meet that. So there's a lot going on here. There's a lot of different things. There's a lot of flexibility in many of the slopes here. And that's really where grading optimization can come in, is when there's this flexibility and you're trying to figure out what the optimal solution is going to be and how to grade it. And then last thing before we jump into Sipple 3D is just, where do you find grading optimization? This is available for customers with the AEC collection and also customers using TokenFlex, which are typically customers with an enterprise business agreement. I imagine most people are probably in the AEC collection spot. So for them, you'd find this either in the Autodesk desktop app. If you just go to your products, you should see it listed there. Grading optimization, mine's already installed, so it's grayed out. But you can also, if you have access to your account online, you can go to manage.autodesk.com, and there under all products and services, you should see the AEC collection. And in that, you can view all included items. For customers with TokenFlex, you may just have to check with your internal Autodesk account manager. They've probably set up a deployment, so they can tell you where to access that. So with that, then once grading optimization's installed, you won't see it on the home tab. There is grading tools here that we've always had. It's not there. This was viewed more of an analysis of an optimization. So you'll find it on the Analyze tab. So all the tools are over on the right here on this grading optimization panel. And there's, we'll get into these in a minute, but there's some UI features, a browser to list all the items, tools on a tool palette, and then also a button to launch the grading optimization itself, which we'll have Val describe what that does.
Yeah, first of all, what does grading optimization actually do? Well, it takes your 2D geometry. So if you look at Charlie's screen here, kind of these polygons, these polylines, and it sets elevation values for you on these 2D geometries. And it does these in a way to satisfy constraints that you're going to set. And these constraints we're going to see, Charlie's going to show with these kind of grading objects. We're going to set them on zones, on lines, things like that. And so the optimizer is always going to try to solve these constraints. It's also going to go after objectives. What is the difference? The objectives you're going to set after in grading optimization. Well, a constraint is kind of a non-negotiable that you have in your design. It's like slope constraints that your design need to satisfy, elevations, like elevation distances, offsets. Objectives are more things that are nice to have. Like, for example, you would like to balance, or you would like to keep your volumes low, or you would like to have nice contours, things like that. And the solver will try to do that as well, but it's always gonna aim for constraints first to make them feasible. So with that, we can basically go and set the first few constraints. Charlie, do you wanna show how to do that?
Yeah, so using the grading object tools, this opens the tool palette, and this is just your Sipple 3D tool palette where you'd find subassemblies. We've just added a couple tabs here for some, a way to add these grading properties. So in our drawing here, we have kind of a simple site with a building in red, a parking lot over here, a new road coming in. There is an existing road that wraps around. It's not shown, but that's kind of the edge of our project. So we don't want to grade into that. We don't want to grade too far off this proposed road. So really we have this polyline in here that's the limit of our work. So I'm going to add that as a grading limit. So we can just use these tools, select a tool from here, and then it's prompting you to select something. So I'll select this polyline to add that as a grading limit. Properties get added to that as a grading limit. And I can just name this.
Always good to rename these things. You will see that in later sessions to organize yourself in the tool after.
And there's a bunch of properties here we don't need to go into right now. I think for now, we'll just concentrate on the slope constraints. So these are constraints like Val mentioned. So there's a maximum slope 3:1. There's a minimum of 2%, but we're actually going to suggest, at least starting out, that we change that to 0. And we'll talk about why this is a not your minimum slope, but a minimum drain slope. And
it's a drain slope, right?
We'll get into that a little bit later.
Actually, we recommend users, if they don't know what they're doing, put this to 0 on your grading limit at first.
And we also recommend maybe just even changing the default. So any of these, you can go in, right click, and go to properties. And then you can change default values here. So I'm going to set the minimum drain as a default to 0. I can always change it later when I'm running an optimization if I want to change what's happening. So it's as simple as that, just to add these properties to your objects. And these are just AutoCAD polylines in my drawing. They could be feature lines, alignments, other objects. So certain things need to be closed. Other ones are open geometry. There is also this object browser, and we'll see there's one grading limit added here. But this is where different types of objects will get shown as we start to add them. So there's also a building pad, right? I'll add that.
And rename it.
Building. And we'll probably talk more about some of these settings later too. One that I am going to change for today, and we'll leave this at this later in a future webcast, but I'm going to set depth of material to 0 for now. Then this affects the earthwork quantity. So typically you probably want to account for depth of material so you're not filling that in or at least cutting that. By setting this to 0, we're just comparing top surfaces, but we can do more in a future webcast. We'll get into that. Just keep it simple for today. And also, there's a road in here, so I have a closed polyline for that. I'm going to add a zone for that and call this
road. Zones are key in grading optimization.
And same thing here. I'm just focused on slopes and then a maximum slope here. And now we have a zone in here. And the last one is the parking area. Also going to add this as a zone. I should point out too, you can select the object first and then pick the tool. It'll also add it. Specifically for the parking lot, we did add an extra tool here. It's really still just a zone, but it lets you pre-configure some default values for parking lot as opposed to just some random zone. So I'm going to call this and again, so it already has the slope set up on it. And I'm just going to set this to 0 again, just like the other one. Just again, it's just going to look at earthwork for top surfaces. So now we have two zones in the zone group. Again, the parking lot does become a zone. So it's as simple as that to start adding constraints to the objects. And now I'm going to run it. Did I say anything right, Val?
Yeah, it's that. We can start the tool. Right. It's that simple, actually.
So we launch creating optimization.
And here you have this 3D view of your surface. You can see the zones. They're colored a little different. One thing that you want to do right at the beginning, so if you go to the lower left, there's an icon there where Charlie's pointing. That's the visualization toolbar. So you need that always. So just turn that on right at the beginning. And up on top, you have this toolbar now, and you can see there are different things we can do. But for just running a first thing, you most likely are interested in the violation view, which is the second where his mouse is there. Yeah, violation view. What is this? Maybe Charlie, if you can quickly start and pause the optimization to update the triangles. So here you can see it puts everything to gray, and a few of the triangles are red. At the bottom right, you can see the legend there. Dark red shows max slope violated. We can see that on the building. The building is supposed to be flat. It's not flat right now. It's going to work on it after, but that's why it's showing dark red. If you hover over these red triangles, you will see a tooltip that shows you actually what's violated. So on top, you can see the slope, which is more than zero. And you can see the setting of this triangle is max is zero. Drain slope is zero as well there. It's not violated. We will later, when we go to drain slopes, we will see different colors in this violation view. You will see like lighter shades of red that have to do with drainage. But for now, the only things that we have here are the max slopes, and this is the only thing that's violated. Now, there's another thing that we wanna, before we run, quickly look at. It's beside the optimize button on the left side are these sliders. Yeah, quickly click on these optimization options. And on top, the global constraints, that's just if you don't have a grading limit. Iterations, you can leave them. We can always stop early. But the interesting thing here are these objective weights. So we talked quickly about objectives, like balancing, minimizing volumes, or smoothing the surface. This is where you can actually tell the solver what you're interested in, what you want the solver to try to minimize in terms of costs. So right now, we only have the smooth surface on. That means we want nice contours that are gradable, but you can also balance. You can minimize the volumes. We're going to see that a bit later. But for now, we just leave it like this. And I think we can run it, Charlie, right?
Yeah, run it here. And smoothing the surface isn't necessarily just nice contours. It's really just trying to minimize the grade difference between
the grade change and
triangles.
Between the triangles, that's right. Now you can see these red triangles, they start disappearing. That means it's solving really hard. Another way to see how your optimization progresses is, again, down at the left, you have this convergence plot. And that's really something that gives you a good idea how things are going. Even, I would say, better than the violation view itself. You always use them together, but this is really a thing that helps you. So what does it tell you? So the top, where it says feasibility, this is basically a plot that tells you how close the solver is to a solution. So with close, we mean if you're at zero, you're at a solution. So you want the thing to go down. You want this thing to go down to zero. And here we can see it really went steeply down and it's approaching something nice there. If you have a really ugly problem where you threw in a lot of constraints and it's not possible to do what you want, the solver will flatten out at a certain distance away from a solution. So, and you will notice that when this curve flattens out, you know, solver can probably not do better. So this is really helpful to know if things are going well or not, or if you need to change something.
We can also see the volume here, right?
We can see the
volume that's 8,000 or 9,000 cubic feet right now,
which is not nicely balanced. So we could probably stop and change that a little bit.
Change some of these objectives, yeah. can set balancing at 100%. Maybe I'll pump this one down to 50 and just pump this one up a little bit. So this is going to balance to try to balance to zero. You could put in some other known value here if you wanted to. And minimize earthworks is going to try to minimize the depths of cut and fill, which it tries to end up minimizing the total cut and fill. So I'll do this and we'll run this again.
You can see it goes down again nicely, but this time the solution will be slightly different. It will move certain triangles up and others down to balance. You can actually see that now right away in the net volume down there. Before we were way higher, and now it's at a pretty decent value. Mind you, these are cubic feet. So for the audience that uses imperial units.
So, I mean, we could let this run a little longer, but I think we'll stop it at this point and go back to Simple 3D and add some more things. So when we're doing that, let me just close these and stop the optimization. We could send the result back to Simple 3D at any time. If we're not really ready yet, we don't need to do that. We can just simply close the tool here. Close the window. So later on, we'll get a better solution. We'll send that back to Civil 3D to see what that looks like. But for now, I'm just going to close grading optimization, go back to Civil 3D. And now we could take a look at what some of that minimum drain slope does. So first, we'll just set this to 2 instead of 0.
One thing you need to understand is this is not your usual min slope. It's a drain slope. So what that means is it's tied to a direction. And what kind of direction is that? We have to help the solver there a little bit. We have to tell them what kind of where it should drain towards. And for that, we have drain lines and low points in the tools there. And what they actually do, we can quickly see in a conceptual in a few conceptual slides. So if this is, for example, this is a surface, a triangular network with triangles. If we draw a drain line on a surface like this and we put a min slope that is greater than 0, what a triangle does, it's going to look for where this drain line is, and it's going to go the shortest way, which is here perpendicular. And then it takes this as a direction where it's going to try to drain, basically. If a triangle is behind the drain line, it's going to tilt towards the tail. And if a triangle is in front, it's going to try to drain towards the tip. The same as the tip happens with triangles that are adjacent to the drain line. So these as well, they're going to make the whole drain channel a little bit inclining so that things flow towards the tip there. So if you do that with all the triangles, you end up with a pattern like this, and we call these direction vectors or drain vectors. And remember, these are the ones that's the intention where water should drain. So what happens if you have two drain lines? Well, for example, we have two like this. Well, similar thing, but a triangle right now, it measures, it goes to both drain lines shortest way, and then it takes the direction that is shorter. So it goes to the closest drain element it can find. That's very important to remember. It goes always to the closest drain element it can find. If we do this again with all the triangles, we end up with a pattern like this. So we have now two channels that are going to be created. So from there, we can actually go and look at this in the tool.
Yeah, so if I do something similar to what we showed in the slide, I could put a couple polylines in here like that, and then add these as drain lines and just pick these two. So two drain lines, we'll just run this and see what it looks like.
Now, if you want to quickly start and pause again, Charlie, and then go in the visualization toolbar. We have there this little thing on the side, hydrology direction vectors. If you click on that, you will see, if you look at the surface careful enough, you can see now these direction vector that we had before on the slides. And this is exactly the pattern that we had on the slide. So these two drain lines in parallel, and you can see like how these triangles are going to try to, they will try to slope towards in these directions at the 2% or whatever we entered here on the parking lot.
And you'll see all the triangles are trying to go over there too, even the ones from far away, which is something to keep in mind.
They go to the closest. Yeah.
So what we're going to do instead of just having these is put some more realistic drain lines where we want to flow, like around where the road is and the proposed road. So I'm going to go back again to Civil 3D. Have these already drawn on a layer, just from copying the curb lines, basically. Select one of these and select similar. So there's a bunch of polylines already drawn here that we can use as drain lines. And like I said, they're just a slight offset from the curb line. So I'm going to add these as drain line. So now we have 6 drain lines added. And we can go back to optimize to see how that changes the grading.
Now, if you think about the drain lines that Charlie just put on the road, because triangles in the road, they're going to go, the ones that are closer to one side go to one side, the others to the others. That should create a nice crown that you want to see on a road. So that's kind of a trick that we're trying to use here.
And one thing we can do, if we don't need to use these two that we just kind of roughly drew in, over on the browser here, you can see those listed. We can turn these off. There's a couple ways. There's some tools here, toggle these off. You can also toggle off the display. So there goes one. Or you can do it in the properties dialog. So there's an active box and there's also a visibility box toggle. So we can, active just means they won't be used by the grading optimization. You could have them visible, but not active, or any combination of that.
You can also turn all the drain lines off, like the visibility. You have these buttons on the group as well. If you want to declutter things, you can do it.
Quickly turn off,
yeah.
Maybe turn off the display.
Okay, so let's go back to our violation view maybe, because now it's much more interesting. You can see we have these lighter red shade triangles. These are now min drain slope violations. You want to hover over one, Charlie, just to see.
Yep, do you see that?
Yeah. So the setting is 1% and we're at, well, it's solving it already. So
it's despairing as ever.
Yeah. By the way, if you want to see more contours, you can do that in the visualization toolbar as well. We have settings there where you can change this interval so that you can see more precise what's going on. And we can turn the convergence block on again to see how it's doing. Looks good, goes down. Now, when do you stop? Like I said, when it's flattening out, that means usually it's not improving things very much anymore. It can't, maybe. So if it's flattening out at a high value, you might want to go back and relax things. That means maybe increase your max slopes or take your drain slopes away, things like that. In this case, it looks really good. So you could let this run for a bit longer. But what do you think, Charlie?
Yeah, for the sake of time, we can stop it now. But yeah, eventually this will, like Val said, flatten out. And that's probably a good time to stop it. It's below, you know, one. So it's pretty much everything that's still remaining is fairly close. Well, some of that's pretty flat, but 0.9 instead of one. So yeah, I mean, you could let it run for a little longer, but for the sake of doing a webcast, I think we can stop this.
The volumes there, they look pretty good. I mean, it's not as good as before, but keep in mind, we threw a lot of constraints in here with this drain slope. So
if we pretend this is what we wanted, this is, we let it run for a little bit longer and it was done. We could return this to Civil 3D, and I'll just go ahead and do that now. So send the result back to Civil 3D, and this will let us choose to bring back the surface. So this will be the optimized surface now, and also feature lines. So we started with 2D polylines, basically. They could have been feature lines. In my case, they were all 2D polylines. So what this will do is return basically the same lines, but now with elevations from that optimized surface on them. So you could use the surface as, you know, maybe kind of doing some checks, or you could create a new surface from the feature lines and add additional feature lines later to get it more detailed. So for this surface, I'm just gonna create a new surface and just call this Geo. And then pick a style. I'm just going to use the 1 in 5 design contours. And then for the feature lines, similar thing. You could create a new site and put these in a new site, or you can toggle this off so it's not in a site, which means it's the siteless feature lines group out here instead of being in a site. And then also chooses a style for those. If I had points, I could return those as well, but I didn't send any low points or any other points. We'll talk about those more in a future webcast. So with this, I'm just going to finish. So it'll create a new surface over here on Prospector and also add the feature lines to the list as well. So we can see now there's a new surface geo. I can see the contours here. Also feature lines. So the feature lines we started with are now being returned with elevations on them. And they're separate objects. So you can still use the original objects to kind of redo your analysis. And this surface here, you can see I have the proposed surface result. Maybe kind of hard to see there. And one last thing, we can just check
volumes. We want to know about the volumes.
Let's give this a name and choose my.
This is really a strength of Geo. I mean, balancing is a tedious thing. It does it all for you. So that's probably one of the stronger features.
So just combined was my existing ground. And Geo is the one we returned. So we'll see here. We get 6. Yeah.
These are cubic yards now. Yeah. So that's about 6 cubic meters for our metric people, which is, what's that, a dump truck? A little more?
All right. So, anything else? I think it's kind of what we wanted to go over in the first session, right, Val?
Yeah, I think that was everything for today.
And we'll get in, I think the next session we plan to take this same site a little bit further, and then in future webcasts, we'll mix it up with some different examples. Let's see, yeah. So I guess that's it for presentation part. John, are there any questions? The Q&A?
There are. So just a couple quick questions here. Can you specify longitudinal and cross slopes in zones?
Right now, no. Right now, no. We just have a maximum slope, which could really be in any direction. The minimum slope, of course, the direction can be specified, but then you can't specify right now a perpendicular slope.
Okay.
We've heard before, though.
I was going to say, I think we've heard that question several times, right?
Yeah. And we heard it.
Totally get, Certainly be better for the roadway, walkways.
So there was a question about the roadway. How did you create the roadway itself? Did you do it in one zone? Did you use two? How did you do that to take into account for slope?
Yeah, so I mean, in our example here, we just did one. Let me just turn all these off so I can.
Yeah, there are different ways how you can do it. Like you could use maybe two zones for a zone for each lane, left and right. But here we just used one zone basically. And then with train lines on either side, it really creates this crown that you want to see.
we didn't really call it out, but the train lines actually, it retriangulates at the midpoint between those. So that helped to create the crown. But for me, this was all just one zone, but we could have broke it up if there were different areas. Maybe at the intersection, you needed it to be flatter. This was pretty flat anyway, but you certainly could break it up, but we didn't.
Yeah, I think that's a good point to make that if you're wanting to control something differently inside of another zone, just create another zone and you should be able to achieve what you're wanting to do. Val and I have sat and we've created zones and zones and zones and zones before,
it's
right?
It's all about zones,
I got tired of hearing, just create another zone. So, they do work very, very well together. There's another question here. Can you specify or can you tell grading optimization to balance cut fill based on elevations below the top surface? This way you're not including paving or select fill. Does that make sense?
It's dripping, right? Or
so is it more like you want to account for the depth of materials or?
Yes, I think so. Well, so it's not including paving or select fill. So
if that's,
I think you would treat that like you were doing the stripping or something, like Val said.
Yeah, exactly, we do have that, this property we skipped over for this session that we'll talk about next time. But a way to specify, so this depth of materials for the road, that would be your pavement and base materials. And then when it does the cut and fill calculations, it won't include this area in the fill and it'll make sure it's cutting that out for cut. So that should account for that.
You will always get the top surface back though. Right now, so what you get back is the top surface, but the volumes that it shows are the ones that include this material.
Yeah, so the volumes would be to underneath all these materials.
Exactly.
So there was a question for someone. I figured I'd throw it out there. They said that they loaded grading optimization, but the grading optimization window didn't come up or didn't show anything inside of it. Have you guys seen that before? I suggested that they maybe update their video driver, but I didn't know if you guys had seen that before. They said that, had they installed .2? Can't remember. I'd have to look back through the notes here, but that could have been something with it.
So nothing showed up, like not even controls and things like that?
Yeah, I don't think so. Nothing.
Oh.
I don't know if it was just a canvas that was blank, but the UI was all there. I feel like we saw that in beta, but I don't remember seeing it.
I didn't ask them if they were running the beta, then part of futures or anything like that. So if you are running beta, then try and install the production version and see if you get it.
And I guess make sure in general you're up to date on the latest.
There was a hot fix recently that fixed some issues we had with balancing. It's very important that you install that hot fix if you.
We've had a couple of updates since the initial release.
Yep. Some good things in some of those updates, like added the retaining wall and things of that nature. So just gives you more functionality. If you can put zones within zones, is it okay for zones to share an edge or overlap edges?
Yes. We can look at this in the next webcast, actually, where you, when you work with multiple zones, like when you open the optimization where you have this tree view and you have all these zones there. We're going to look at that next time, but basically you can slide, this is a hierarchy, the order in which these zones are shown here. So the top ones, they override what's underneath. So, but we're going to see that in the next webcast in more detail. But basically when you have overlapping zones, the one that is above the other one in this list wins.
Well, I had one. Here we go. Can you specify the locations of your high points or ridges?
Not. So, I mean, you could put a bounded elevation on it, but that's not necessarily, I think, what they need. So just a general location where to cause it to break, basically, as a high point. That we cannot really do right now. So I'm missing something about.
No, like you said, you can have bounded points where you can set bounds on, you can put a point and say, look, you have to be between this and this elevation. But that's not, I don't think that's what this person was asking. They were more asking, where is it going to fill up? But if, for example, if you're balancing, you don't really have control over that. The solver will fill up wherever it's easiest, where there are less constraints, where it can be steeper, for example. So it's all influenced by whatever you set up around, like zones. Like if you set somewhere a zone that is really flat, it will not create a high point there, right?
Yeah, and there might be some tricks we can do, maybe like using elevation offset if we had a...
And then, of course, the drain lines. I mean, in a parking lot, for example, you can get to fancy drain patterns. We did that too. Charlie did that on a site, on a commercial site, diamond patterns, things like that. And if you think what we showed in these slides, how these triangles are going to try to incline themselves, you can just place your drain lines accordingly, and it creates this diamond pattern, and you will have your high points at the corners, right?
All right. One other question here, and I'll take this off your shoulders and I'll answer it. It says, can we run optimization on an existing FG surface created traditionally to show where it could be improved? Not on the FG surface. It's, well, yeah, I mean, you can, here, let's start from here. Whenever you go to optimize, the first thing, the last question it asks you before it jumps into the optimization window is what surface do you want to use, okay, to optimize to. So you can pick an FG surface if you have it in there. And a lot of folks will do that if they have an FG surface that they've used, they've created traditionally maybe, and then they want to add something simple like a detention pond. Okay, we're going to show that how to create detention ponds in a later session also. So please come and watch, because it's an eye opener. Very, very quick to create those. So they'll do that and merge that information into their FG surface. Now, as far as optimizing an FG surface, just to see if it can be improved. Sure, you could grab that surface, throw a zone. You could throw as many zones on as you want, but you can keep it simple. And just if you've got it in your head how you want it or where you want it to improve, you can just put zones in those areas and see what it'll do against that FT surface. So to answer your question, I believe, yes, you can do that. Unless I'm wrong, guys, and tell me if I'm
wrong. No, you were right. Okay. You can do it.
All right. I took a shot in the dark. No, I'm kidding. So that's pretty much all the questions that we have. There was a good question here. Is there someone we can contact for any follow-up questions?
That would be John.
Oh, here we go.
Under Charlie.
My email address is val. Yeah. If you know, if you have questions on this, you're more than welcome to email me, and I can relay those or just answer them.
Yeah, you can email any of us.
Yeah, I mean, our email address is simple. It's our first and last name at autodesk.com. So john.sayer at autodesk.com. So I took it for you guys there. So
thank you, John.
You're more than welcome to email me at any time on this.
It's a nice birthday present for Charlie.
Yeah, it is. Happy birthday. We should sing to him.
That's all right.
I don't think anybody wants to hear that, right? No. But again, that's all the questions that I see. Okay. So we'll go ahead and end the Q&A and turn it over to you, Charlie.
Sure. I did see one asking about the data set we were using. This is actually one of the samples that gets installed here. It's called Corner Lot. Although it is a little bit different, I kind of tweaked the design a little. I think the row and the building's the same, but changed the parking lot a little slightly and the sidewalk. But in general, yeah, you could probably use this same surface and everything to try out what we did today. So great. So thanks again, everyone, for joining. This YouTube session will be saved to our channel, the Autodesk Infrastructure channel. So you can watch it again later, share it with coworkers. And also remember to down below, set reminders for our future sessions. Again, the next one is in 2 weeks. All the links are there though below the description under the video. So thanks again, John, for helping with questions. And thanks to the team behind the scenes that helped us run smoothly. And thank you, everyone, for your time joining today. And have a great day. Thanks.
See you, everyone.
Hey, everybody.